Translator's Preface. The charming story of Gudrun is a romance of the old heroic period, written by some unknown poet of Austria or Bavaria in the 13th century. Next to the Nibelungen Lied, it is the most important of the German epic poems. Indeed, some of the personae in Gudrun are found in the Lied, though varying in personal characteristics, probably because they were taken from different legends. The scenes of Gudrun are principally laid along the shores of the North Sea and in Normandy. The men and women in this poem resemble generally those in the Lied. The same elemental passions are depicted. The men are brave, vigorous heroes, rejoicing in battle and feats of prowess. The women are beautiful, constant, and courageous. There are many fine delineations of character in the original, as well as vigorous sketches of northern scenery. The figure of Gudrun stands out in bold relief among the maidens. There are few more beautiful characters indeed in the poems of the old heroic period, and it adds to the charm of the epic that she does not suffer the tragic fate of Kriemhild in the Nibelungen Lied, but that her constancy and devotion are rewarded by her ultimate reunion with her knightly lover, King Hervig. There are many serious passages, but from the very first there is the conviction that Gudrun and Hervig, in spite of all the dangers and vicissitudes through which they pass, will in the end be reunited. And so it happens. Gudrun's name is always spoken by her people with reverence. Her courage and constancy were extolled by them, and in after days her fame was as radiant as the stars in the heavens. GPU, Chicago, July 1, 1906. Chapter 1. The Maiden and the Princely Suitor. There once lived in Denmark a mighty king named Hetal, whose fame spread far and wide. His wife Hilda bore him two children, a son and a daughter, called Ortvin and Gudrun, who were endowed with such surpassing strength and beauty that as they grew to manhood and womanhood, the whole country rang with their praises. Ortvin's master in arms was Count Vata, a hero who loved the strife and tumult of battle better than making merry with fair dames, and from him the young prince acquired skill in all knightly exercises. Gudrun grew up so tall and strong that she too could have wielded a sword with credit, had such feats been seemly for a maiden, and when the brother and sister stood side by side, all who beheld them declared no sculptor could have wrought anything half so beautiful. Princes came from far and near to seek Gudrun in marriage, but her haughty father, King Hetal, sent them all away, some departing in sorrow, others with bitterness and anger in their hearts. Among those attracted by the fame of Gudrun's beauty was Siegfried, king of Moreland, to whom seven princes did homage as their lord. With a splendid retinue he appeared at Hetal's court to sue for the hand of the maiden, only to share the fate of all her other suitors. Filled with rage and chagrin, he took his departure, vowing never to rest till he had wrought vengeance on the proud monarch. In Normandy at this time, there lived a prince named Hartmut, who no sooner heard of Gudrun than he too was seized with a desire to make her his wife. His mother, Queen Gerlinda, gladly assented to his wishes, for she was an overbearing and ambitious woman, and longed to see her son distinguished above all the other princely wooers. But his father, King Ludwig, said to him, "How do we know if this Gudrun be as fair as report paints her? Yet were she the very flower of maidenhood, it would profit thee little, for bethink thee how far our realm doth lie from Denmark. Never would her parents permit their only daughter to go so far from them." Hartmut was not to be moved from his purpose by these remonstrances, however, and Gerlinda said,
"Let messengers be dispatched thither, and I will bestow gold upon them besides costly apparel."
But Ludwig, foreboding evil, continued, "King Hetal and his wife Hilda are well known to me. Haughty and overbearing are they both, and 'tis like their daughter will prove the same."
"Be that as it may," replied Hartmut, "I cannot live if Gudrun be not mine. In truth, if I may not win her in peaceful fashion, then will I go with an army and wrest her from them by force of arms."
Gerlinda, too, urged and entreated the king, till at last he yielded and consented to Hartmut's making the attempt.
"As to an army," he said, "there is yet time enough for that. Let us first see what may be peacefully accomplished."
Accordingly, Hartmut chose 60 knights from the noblest houses in the land to lay his suit before King Hetal. They set out forthwith, attired in rich garments, their spotless armor shining in the sun, while 12 superb sumpter horses followed, led by retainers and laden with gold and silver. Full 100 days passed before they reached the borders of Hetal's kingdom, where they found a warlike people, most of them going about in helm and mail. They asked where the king was to be found, and were shown the way to the royal castle, Hegelingen. As they rode up to it, the people came flocking about them, full of eager curiosity to gaze at the splendid strangers, while the king ordered sumptuous lodgings to be prepared for them. On the 12th day, they were summoned before Hetal, who, seated on a shining throne and surrounded by his vassals, received them graciously and asked their errand. One of the knights stepped forward and delivered to him the letter containing King Ludwig's suit for his son Hartmut, but scarcely had he learned its contents when his brow darkened and he cried angrily, "Now, by my faith, doth Ludwig dare to dishonor my crown with such proposals? Let him seek a queen for his son where'er it pleaseth him, but approach not my throne with his presumptuous desires." At these words there was a stir among the Norman knights, and their swords seemed to rattle in their sheaths, but they restrained themselves, and one ventured to reply, "Hartmut is well worthy to be thy son-in-law, O king, for truly there is no braver knight alive." Thereupon Queen Hilda, who sat beside the king, lifted her head haughtily and said, "Knowest thou not that thy prince was liegeman to my father, King Hagen, whose fame hath surely reached thine ears? And shall the son of my father's vassal lead our child homeward as his bride?"
Therewith the knights were dismissed, and the next morning they left the court. Full of hope and impatience, Hartmut looked forward to their return, but their appearance, when at last they rode into the courtyard, boded him little good. Reluctantly they made known the answer of Hetal and Hilda to his suit, whereat Ludwig foamed with rage, and Gerlinda burst into a storm of angry tears. But Hartmut asked one of the knights whether the maiden was really so beautiful as it was said.
"In truth, my lord," he replied, "so fair is she that he who once beholds her must ever bear her image in his heart."
"Now may God chastise King Hetal for the affront he hath dealt to me and to my house, but for the maiden she shall yet be mine, I swear."
These words gladdened Gerlinda's heart.
"Ha!" she cried, trembling with passion. "May I but live to behold her here."
Chapter 2. The Contest. Zealand, the neighboring country to Denmark, was ruled by a young prince named Hervik, who also came to woo the fair Gudrun, but Hetal rejected him as haughtily as he had rejected all the rest. Nevertheless, Hervik tarried for some months at the court, where, from time to time, he might behold the maiden, but although he often renewed his suit, the king's answer was ever the same. One day, a prince arrived at the royal castle, followed by a glittering train. He would not give his name, and as he advanced no suit, Hetal received him kindly and prepared a feast in his honor. So it came to pass that he soon found an opportunity of seeing Gudrun, and contrived to make known to her that he was Hartmut, and had come to Denmark for her sake alone. The maiden pitied the gallant young hero, whose appearance pleased her well, though she had no wish to wed him, and she besought him to depart at once, for should Hetal discover who he was, he would surely slay him. Sorrowfully, Hartmut left the court. Yet he did not abandon his purpose, but bent all his energies toward raising an army to revenge himself upon King Hetal. Hervik was rejoiced when the splendid stranger went upon his way, for he had feared in him a successful rival. Again he would have renewed his own suit, but the king sternly forbade him ever again to speak of it, whereupon he resolved to invade the land with an armed force to prove to the haughty monarch that he too was a mighty prince. Accordingly, on a dark night not long thereafter, when all within the castle of Hegelingen lay wrapped in deepest slumber, Hervik landed with a band of stout warriors, and at daybreak the warder on the tower discovered the enemy close beneath the walls.
"To arms!" he thundered from the tower. The trump the silence broke, and strident blast of larum horns the startled sleepers woke. With flying hair the women all to one another clung, or flocking to the windows there, their hands in terror wrung, while calm in danger knight and man to steed and armor sprung. When Hetal saw by the device on the banners that it was Hervik who led the foe, he was secretly pleased that the hero should thus seek to win the maid by force of arms. This was after his own heart,
and Hervik could not have hit upon a better plan to obtain his favor. With his wife and Gudrun, he stood at a window and watched the gallant struggle that was in progress before the castle, expecting to see his knights soon scatter the followers of this fiery war. But great was his consternation when he beheld Hervik gaining step by step. Wherever the rejected suitor's plume waved, wherever his flashing sword circled, there was the fray hottest, and many of Hedel's stoutest warriors fell before him. Splendid was Hervik to look upon in battle. The helms of all who approached him were lit with fiery sparks, while their armor was speedily adorned with crimson bands. Even Gudrun gazed on him with admiring eyes, terrible as the sight of the battle was to her.
"Now," thought Hedel, "is Hervik worthy of my sword?"
And donning his armor, down he strode, only to find his men being irresistibly forced back within the castle. Already the clash of arms re-echoed from the vaulted ceiling. Armor crashed against armor in the onset. Valiantly, King Hedel dashed among his knights, but all his efforts were powerless to check their retreat. At last the two princes came face to face, the gray-haired hero of 100 battles, and the young warrior bent on winning equal fame. Blows that would have slain many a stout champion fell thick and fast on helm and shield, yet undismayed and unconquered fast they stood, while sparks shot forth in fiery showers, and links of mail fell tinkling to the stone floor. At last Hedel stepped back a pace and said breathlessly,
"He who does not wish me for a friend surely is no good friend,"
and therewith rushed once more upon the young hero, and fiercer than ever raged the combat. Terror-stricken, Gudrun watched them until at last she could bear it no longer. Seizing a shield, she hastened down and threw herself between the two knights, whereat Hervik lowered his sword and gazed joyously at the stately maiden.
"Peace, peace, my father, in God's name," she implored. "Let the struggle wait until I have asked Hervik where his dearest friend may be."
"Oh, thou knowest well," cried Hervik, "but I will give no peace till thou dost grant me leave to speak with thee within the castle. No evil have I in my heart, for unarmed will I enter."
Accordingly, at Gudrun's desire, the heroes laid aside their arms and entered the castle together in peace. Then Hervik approached Gudrun once more to plead his suit, and Gudrun answered,
"What maid could scorn so valiant a hero? Truly, most noble Hervik, there is no damsel living who could hold thee more dear than I, and if my parents do consent, then will I gladly evermore with thee abide."
Then Hervik besought the king and queen for the hand of Gudrun, and they, turning to their daughter, asked whether this betrothal would be pleasing to her. She replied that she would choose Hervik for her husband before all other men. So Hedel, whose heart had been quite won by the valor of the noble young hero, led Gudrun to him, and joined their hands together. Then all the great lords and vassals were summoned to the hall, and in their presence the king once more asked Gudrun if she would have Hervik for her husband.
"Never could I wish for nobler lord," she answered.
So they were betrothed, and a great feast was held to celebrate the joyful event. When the festivities were over, Hervik wished to take Gudrun home with him as his bride, but Queen Hilda besought him to wait till the following springtime, since her daughter was still so young. In the meantime, she would teach her much that it befitted a future queen to know, and she would also have time to prepare a rich store of marriage gifts.
Hervik agreed to this, though with great reluctance.
Soon thereafter, bidding a sorrowful farewell to his betrothed, he returned to his own land, little suspecting what dire results were to follow the postponement of the nuptials.
Chapter 3. Siegfried's Revenge. The news that Hervik had won the heart and hand of the beautiful Gudrun soon spread to Moreland and filled King Siegfried, still smarting from his own scornful rejection, with deadly hatred against the fortunate suitor.
"Now will I kindle for thee, Sir Hervik," he shouted, "a wedding torch that shall light thy whole land."
Forthwith he had 20 ships made ready and filled with chosen knights. Toward the end of May they reached the coast of Zealand, and then began such a burning and slaying as never had been known before. Hervik at once rode forth to meet his fierce enemy, and a long and desperate battle followed. Red was the soil with the blood of the slain, and bravely did Hervik and his warriors fight, but at last they were forced to yield to superior numbers and take refuge.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.